So welcome to the show. Today we're here with Mike Cupino, a fantastic music producer, music technologist, and Able certified technician. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So we want to talk about today some tips and tricks for, you know, getting started producing or what your workflow is like. Mm-hmm. So just to start me off, why don't you tell me a bit about what you do like in production?
So I work for a few artists here in Miami, mm-hmm. mainly a lot of dance and pop music and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But I also, one of the things that I like to do is, I love doing is music for advertising and stuff like that. So mm-hmm. that allows me to do a lot of different things, you know, because mm-hmm. primarily, you know, doing a lot of dance and pop, but when you do music for advertising, you know, it's do something like this with a little bit of this and a little bit of that. So that's one of the things I really enjoy about doing that type of stuff, is really kind of helps me kind of stretch the borders of sometimes of different genres I get to do. So I get to do some like hybrid orchestra type stuff and, you know, even some acoustic type stuff too, which is cool. And it's kind of nice to get away from the all in the box kind of electronic world every now and then, you know, and get back to kind of some of the things of my roots of, you know, real instruments, acoustic instruments and stuff like that too. So that's nice.
Cool. Tell me about your roots then. What are your musical?
Originally started as a drummer. Started as a drummer, picked up drums about 12 or 13. I did that. I was actually wanted to be a music education. I was originally got into music education and did that for a little bit. And I was a total band nerd. Nice. And I did a lot of this stuff, which is called indoor percussion ensemble. So I competed in this circuit called WGI. And I did that really heavily for a few years. And I even was teaching in the North Carolina area, and I was writing and arranging for drum lines and percussion ensembles for about 4 or 5 years in the Charlotte area. And I was teaching at like 2 or 3 schools in that area. And those were a lot of things where it kind of set me on my course. And a lot of things that I do now, I kind of harken back, and it's like, you know, because production is basically arrangement, you know. So those are where I picked up a lot of the things that I like to do to this day, and kind of a lot of the ideas of how I like to produce and stuff like that. So I got into that, and in the late 90s, early 2000s, I feel really lucky because I caught the first initial wave of everything going to computers. I got Rebirth. Did you ever use Rebirth?
Yeah, absolutely.
Rebirth was awesome, man. You know, the 2303s, the 808, yeah. The 909. So that was, I had a little Oxygen 8 and Rebirth, and that was like the start of everything for me. And then Reason came along, and that was like a absolute game changer. So I feel lucky because I got in at Reason 1, and I feel really lucky because I almost feel like when I teach students today, it's almost a little overwhelming, like all the stuff you can do with music technology these days. So I feel lucky, like I kind of almost grew up with it a little bit. So when things started coming into the computers, and then, so like as the technology advanced, I was learning it as the technology advanced. So I feel like I got in at a really good time.
Yeah, so you had a limited palette, right?
Exactly, limited
developed
things.
Yeah.
Yeah, and developed in more tools. That's the thing I talk a lot to the people I teach, is that, you know, the idea of option paralysis. You know, mm-hmm. guys get so many tools, so many different things, and then you sit in the studio and you're like, what can I do? Well, the possibilities are truly endless. And then that really puts people in a lot of like just that kind of option paralysis, because there's so many options that you can do. So
you have so many tools at your disposal, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
How do you pick which one to become a master of?
So exactly.
What would you recommend, since you do work with students, if they are getting started, mm-hmm. which plugins or which, you know, types of plugins should they master first of all?
I really tell a lot of people, whatever DAW you're using, mm-hmm. whether it be Logic, Pro Tools, obviously I'm really big into Ableton, is stick with just built-in native tools as much as you can. You know, especially in my case, Ableton has some fantastic native tools. So get into those, because yeah, it gets a little overwhelming. You know, there's a lot of guys that get into that plug-in game. I got this plug-in. And but I find, you know, if you get in and just work within your DAW a lot, just study those tools and then kind of branch out from there and then kind of extend things. So, I mean, that's the thing nowadays. There's so many, DAWs come with so many good tools. I mean, you know, 10, 15 years ago, they didn't really come with a whole lot, you know? You know, you had to buy this, buy that. Logic was pretty good, but...
Well, Pro Tools didn't come, like, you had to
Pro Tools
on.
Didn't come anything. Yeah, that was one of the things that, like, you'd get Pro Tools and you had no way to make sounds, like, internally in Pro Tools. Yeah, it was just EQs, it was compressors, there was no, like... I don't think there were there any like internal like any instruments?
No, I think you had to pay for the add-on reverb actually as well.
Yeah, I think so. Everything was like an add-on. So it was really it was really crazy. But nowadays it's totally different. I mean, that's one of the things that's really great about, you know, Logic. Logic comes with like an enormous amount of content, especially all the Apple loops and stuff like that. And so they got a lot of really, really good tools. So within just one DAW nowadays, there's enough to get lost just for months in that stuff. So work, you know, I highly suggest tell people, you know, work within the native instruments of your DAW. And then depending on what you're into, you know, look at the artists who are in your genre and find out, you know, the plugins and the synths they use and then try to go from there, you know.
So what are some examples of artists and tools that they might use, let's say like in a dance genre or in a pop genre?
Yeah, well, definitely in the dance genre, you know, definitely, you know, Serum's like the hot ticket synth these days, you know, so, and that's a great synth to learn with, especially because the layout's so simple, and it's great. I actually don't mind teaching synthesis with Serum because everything's so... like just well laid out. It's just really just one panel. There's not like a bunch of stuff hidden. So Serum's a great one. But I also really like going back to like a lot of really basic synths. You know, that's one of the things like sometimes people knock on Ableton's analog synth because it's real kind of basic. But you know, my philosophy is with a synth like that, if you can make that thing sound good, you can make any synth sound good. So, you know, if you really learn to work those basic parameters and get something sounding really good with those basic parameters, when you jump to something like Serum or Omnisphere or something like that, then it just, you know, multiplies the capabilities that you're able to do.
Do you think there's a big distinctive sound between a lot of these power synths, like a Massive or a Serum? I mean, they are kind of using a lot of the same models.
Yeah, it seems like everything's wavetable these days. Yeah. Like Serum, there's Pigment, and there's stuff like that. For me, one of the things that I've really come to realize is it's all about workflow for me. You know, that's one of the things that, you know, and it varies from person to person, but that's one of the things why I really enjoyed using Ableton from the start was just the workflow. You know, people ask me all the time, oh, do you have this synth? Do you have that synth? And I'm like, well, if it really doesn't fit in my workflow, I'm not really going to use it. So it's all about productivity for me. You know, if I can get what I want and need out of a project quick and efficiently, that's really what it's all about. I don't care how awesome or amazing the sounds it can make. If I can't get work done in time, then it's, you know, it's kind of pointless.
So let's dive into that. Let's say you do get a deadline, you've got a job coming up, you've got 4 hours to make a track. Workflow, speed, this is vital, right?
Yes, it is. It's very, very super vital.
Yeah, so this is a two-part question. One is, how do you start when you just got that blank canvas in front of you? Mm-hmm. What's the first thing you do? And then the second would be, how, in terms of workflow, do you have like a preset template? Are there things that you gravitate to and just already, you know, have set up?
Yeah, so as far as templates, I used to have like a template that had like a lot of different synths and stuff like that. Mm. And my template's actually really basic now because I find, depending on the project, you know, I could use lots of different things. So I'd end up like deleting half the synths when I would work in some of my templates. Yeah. So my template really just includes like an audio track and a MIDI track and literally like 12 synths because
so the default one, but just with auxiliaries,
tons of auxiliaries. Because I mean, that was one of the things I was finding. I would always use a couple of different reverbs, like a quarter note delay, half note delay, dotted eighth delay. So I just kind of got annoyed with having to load all that stuff up. So those were the only things that I was like consistently using, reverbs, delays, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So that, as far as my template, that's the only thing that I have. But for me, you know, my work varies, but that's one of the things that I really appreciate about doing music for advertising and stuff like that is because generally they give me a reference. And, mm-hmm. you know, at least for me, you know, if I have like, if someone says just make anything, I kind of have a little bit of trouble because, you know, same thing with that option paralysis. Like,
yeah.
if I could make anything, like, well, what do I want to make? I like so much stuff, so I could spend all day just trying to figure out what I want to make. So
sure.
with advertising stuff, a lot of times there's references. So if there's a reference, that helps out a lot. And mm-hmm. at least for me, that's one of the reasons why I like working with people too as well. Mm-hmm. You know, if I'm set, have to sit in a room to my own vices, like I think I just drive myself crazy. And it's kind of funny because I originally went down the music production path because I got tired of working with people. You know, as a drummer, I was originally a drummer, no musician is more reliant on other musicians. You can't just,
yeah.
how many like just famous drummers do you know? I mean, like there's not, I mean, it's Max Weinberg for Conan, but that's really Buddy Rich, but there's no like just famous drummers. So I got in this to get around working with people. And then some 20 years later, I started realizing like, wow, I'm really lonely in the studio. I don't like working just with my ideas. So I really like it if someone's like, hey, here's an idea. Let's see where you can take it. So a lot of times for advertising or if I'm working with someone, there's, at least for me, there's a conceptual idea. But, you know, if I have to come up with a conceptual idea, you know, a lot of times it starts from music for me. You know, I depending on like the emotion or the vibe I want to create, I generally try to do that harmonically first.
Before we get to there, it seems to me like what you're saying though is being a producer in the way that you are, and really I am as well, it's different than being a songwriter in that.
Very much,
yeah.
very much. I don't think I would succeed as much being just a songwriter.
Mm-hmm.
I think, like I said, I really, you know, like I said, I was a drummer, and one of the things I really liked about being a drummer is like when you're in a room with a bass player and you're playing a groove and the bass player does something and he changes it up a little bit and there's that back and forth
yeah.
that happens. And I actually spend a lot of my time when I work with singers and other artists, I try to have as much of that as possible. It's one of the things I find that's kind of disturbing in like a lot of way things are produced. It's just like, let me produce a track and then you sing on top of it. Mm-hmm. I don't feel there's any of that creative back and forth between the music. So, you know, when I work with singers and artists a lot, I try to go back and forth. You know, that's one of the things I have them early a lot of times, you know, I was mentioning I do the harmonics first. So mm-hmm. I like to work, you know, I'm working with a singer, I'll do the chord progression and I'll keep it real basic and I'll lay scratch vocals. So that way, at least I can work and see what the vocals are doing and produce around that
a little bit. So to define that though, harmonics being the scale, the key, the chord changes.
Exactly, all that stuff. The chord progression and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes that does change, especially in advertising. I'll start with a little bit of a chord progression and stuff and I'll start producing. And then I'll realize things need to change. But mm-hmm. for the most part, I try to get, you know, the chord progression and the melodies and stuff like that down first.
Nice.
I find it's best to compartmentalize some things. I find a lot of people are more productive when they compartmentalize the processes. You know, do all the musical stuff, then do all the sound design stuff, then do all the mixing stuff and all that stuff. Unfortunately, with the tight timelines of advertising, you have to do all that stuff all at once. And I've gotten pretty good at it. And that's why like sometimes I tell like my students, you know, do as I say, don't do as I do, because sometimes I work like that. I do everything all at once, which is kind of a maddening process a little bit.
But I think that also comes with experience.
It does. Because I know the end results. You know, when you're young and you haven't produced a lot of things, you don't know what the end result is. So it's really hard for you to quantify all the processes you do and how they'll actually turn up in the end.
Yeah.
You know, but once you see the end result and you can see the beginning result, all the processes in between start to become a lot more clear, you know, once you've done it a few times. But that's just, like you said, comes from experience and having enough ending results. And, you know, that's at least for me, I always tell people, finish tracks, because something happens in that moment when you finish a track that, I don't know, I feel like you learn more in the moment when you finish a track than you did through like the whole process, you know. Something very, I don't know, I guess it's like cathartic of just finishing a track and saying I'm done with it. But once again, that takes maturity, because I know a lot of guys that just tinker with songs for months, and that's why it's good to have timelines and stuff like that, and deadlines and stuff like that. So
I think based on what we were talking about, that's where Captain comes in, is a really good generative tool to create chords, content, kind of help inspire in that way.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like I was talking about that back and forth, you know, you don't, you know, unfortunately I don't always have someone to work with, you know, and that's where like something like Captain can, at least it simulates that kind of back and forth, or at least gives me an idea.
That's interesting.
You know, and you were mentioning too, like working with sound to picture, you know, there is that back and forth, you know, that the picture spawns, you know, a creative idea in me, and then I do something to that. So I do find those tools are very, very useful. And I also kind of get, you know, sometimes I get geeky into like some of the Max for Live, like Euclidean sequencers, and like really weird random sequencers and stuff like that are really cool to just kind of capture a spontaneous idea. And sometimes those little spontaneous ideas can be, you know, a start to something else, you know, and sometimes, you know, it just takes sitting in front of a piano and just doodling. One of the things that Ableton added in, I guess it was in 10, they have this feature called Capture. So Ableton actually just records MIDI in the background the whole time. So whether you're recording or not, it's actually recording. So you can do something on the piano and you'd be like, oh, what did I just do? And then it'll actually grab it and throw it and create a MIDI clip for you. I can't tell you how invaluable that has actually been. I mean, how many times have you been like jamming with a loop and just playing something and be like, oh, that was really cool, and be like, what did I do? Like, I really wish I remembered that. So Capture has been really, really great for me in those moments. And there's something real about red light fever. You know, when the recorder's rolling, I don't know, sometimes my brain just goes, you know, and then I just can't do it. So that's really cool about Capture. I can just hit play and just do my thing, and then know that it is actually recording, because like I said, that red light fever is just, I don't know, it just makes me go sometimes.
Well, it stole that from Logic.
Yeah. I mean, it's been around. Well, I mean, I think like the Motif had something like that.
Yeah.
And I think even Fruity Loops has had something like that, you know.
Yeah,
so
Capture Last Take is recording is like a keyboard feature. Mm-hmm. But not, maybe it's not discoverable.
Yeah,
it's discoverable.
One of the things that's cool with, one of the things that Ableton, which is really pretty astounding, is Ableton actually will analyze and beat detect out of it. So you can like not have play going or metronome anything, and you can play a phrase and it'll detect the beat out of it. And then when you hit capture, it creates a clip and it sets your project tempo at that tempo.
Wow.
Which is,
that's great.
Yeah, which is pretty,
it's pretty great.
Well, first time I saw it, I was like, wow, that's pretty mind-blowing, you know?
Yeah.
Because sometimes, yeah, you're just like, what am I going to do? I just let me play something, and then it's already figured out the BPM for you and all that stuff, which is great.
So that back and forth relationship between yourself and a plugin, that a plugin can feed back and inspire what you're going to write.
Exactly.
I feel like Captain Melody, for me, has been really great for that, just this tool that
it's
yeah
it's really neat, you know, to be able to generate something. And sometimes, I mean, it could even be something too, even like a cool synth patch can do that, you know, especially nowadays a lot of these synth patches have arpeggiators in them, they have all sorts of movement and stuff like that. So sometimes, you know, even good sound libraries can be that initial seed of an idea, you know. And so sometimes, you know, good libraries can also give me that generative feeling of something kind of giving back a little bit. But yeah, Captain Melody is great. Even the early iterations of it had some really cool stuff, and now it's totally like a melodic generative tool for you, and with lots of different possibilities, and you can edit it and do all sorts of really, really cool stuff with it.
Yeah, absolutely. I find even like finding chord changes within Captain Chords, just that can spark an idea, just
exactly
like you're saying.
Well, that's one of the things I tell people about, you know, sometimes musicians get snobby about, you know, when I show them Captain Chords, but one of the things immediately for me that I realized about it all right away, because sometimes I like to pick up different instruments because I write different with different instruments, you know, like when you write a chord progression on a guitar, it's very different than when you write a chord progression on piano, just because of the physicality of the instruments and the way the notes are arranged. And that's one of the things I really appreciate about Captain, is it, you know, when I don't know, when you go to the piano, just my fingers just naturally play C minor. You know, I don't know, what is it for you? Do you have just like that chord that you just play on the piano every time?
I probably would say I'm in the E minor, A minor.
E minor, A minor.
Like just that pentatonic shape versus the C minor, G minor one.
Yeah. For some reason, I don't know, I played mallet instruments a lot, and I don't know, I guess for some reason I guess C minor just fit. But
I do like the the B flat Lydian to F thing, like, okay, that's kind of a thing.
So, like when I sit at a piano, there's just certain chords and things that just my hands feel natural doing.
Yeah.
But that gets kind of stagnant. And that's what's great about Captain, is it allows me to venture into other keys and stuff and scales that I just normally would never do. I also find that's really interesting with the push Ableton has on the push. They have all the pads, and they can constrain to different scales and keys and stuff like that. And just even randomly picking notes and being like, oh, that's, I would have never played that on a piano. And that can spark something, you know, just like, oh, that's an interesting tonality that I would have never played on my own. And, oh, that's really cool. I can do something with that.
Because, you know, when you got into making music, you're following your ear.
Yeah, exactly.
You were inspired by creating something that you heard. Using tools like this, you're following your ear to create something you want to hear, right?
Exactly. I think that's a large part of the drummer in me. Mm-hmm. You know, as a drummer, you know, it's one of the coolest things I always appreciate being a drummer is getting to like kind of sit back in the pocket and listen to like what everyone else is doing, you know, and like cueing off what the bass player, the guitar player is doing and all the vocals and stuff like that. So I don't know, for being a drummer for years, I felt like it gave me an insight in terms of like sitting in the pocket and listening to what's happening around me and making sure things connect, you know. I always felt drums were that important tie between rhythm and melody, you know, that kind of made that stuff happen.
So you work with a lot of people and a lot of students as well. Do you think it's important to be an instrumentalist in addition? Like if someone wants to be a producer nowadays, do they have to be able to play an instrument, or is that not mandatory?
You know, I if anyone who knows me, I actually make this joke a lot, and it's kind of bad, but I always used to joke around that musicians make bad producers. And it's obviously not any truth to it, but it's just kind of a joke. But musicians sometimes get caught up in what feels fun to play. You know, and sometimes what's fun to play isn't necessarily what sounds good or what a track needs. So I find sometimes guys that have never touched an instrument have, and that's why I find like DJs make great producers, because DJs are constantly listening. They're always trying to figure out how the people react to the music. And that understanding of how people react to the music is, I think, one of the most important things. Because sometimes as an instrumentalist, your feeling is how you react to the music. That's kind of, I don't know, kind of selfish in a way. So, you know, you're just trying to make yourself happy. So there's a lot of self-gratification sometimes as a musician. But as a DJ, it's, you know, if you don't make people happy, you're not going to be a very successful DJ.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
So it's always about kind of like what the people want to hear. So DJs have a really good insight into like what people want to hear and what sounds good in a track. So it definitely does help to play an instrument, at least in the musical sense, and, you know, understanding how harmonies work and, you know, melodies and chord progressions and stuff like that, definitely makes it easier. But it's not vital. You know, one of the things that I talk about sometimes is, do you ever play GoldenEye on the Nintendo 64?
No, but I've heard, yeah.
GoldenEye was like the first most successful first-person shooter. But the people that created that game had basically little or no experience in the video game world. But that kind of like out of left field insight of like, oh, well, this is the way I think it should be. Instead of just going with all the things that have been established and the norms, they went from a totally different angle and created like one of the most classic video games of all times. And that's what I think, if you listen to a lot of music now, I think that's happening a lot. There's a lot of music that is like counterintuitive to the way musicians would play it happening. I mean, that's what I think all of dance music is originally,
100%.
Like house, house music and all that stuff.
And now like trap music and all that.
And all trap music, exactly.
Yeah, like let me put a bunch of limiters on this and slam this and mix it this way.
It sounds like so totally wrong, but right at the same time.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things, like, when trap music came along, the snobby person in me was like, what is this? But I started seeing it more of an art form rather than something technical. And that's one of the things I find, I don't know, I spent so much of my life in the technical side of things that I don't have these like artistic surprises anymore, because everything's so planned and calculated for me. But that was one of the things that I find that's refreshing about trap music, is just guys just doing whatever in the studio, whatever feels good to them. Nothing's planned, it just whatever that comes out. And I kind of envy that in a lot of ways, because like I said, everything's so planned and methodical for me. So, and then I started seeing the beauty in a lot of trap music. I started seeing it as more artistic, less technical, which is I find more interesting nowadays than more technical, less artistic, you know, in terms of music.
Do you have any tips for kind of overcoming that technical this reliance then? Hurdle?
Yeah, just getting totally geeked out and trying to do stuff. It's hard, man. I had to like really like reprogram my brain to appreciate and kind of understand that a lot. Because, you know, when I was a drummer, everything was technical. I loved playing odd meters, crazy music. And, you know, even when I first started getting into electronic music, I was into really technical stuff. A lot of it comes, at least for me, the start of it was appreciating that stuff, you know, because at first I didn't appreciate it. I saw it. I was like, oh, these guys don't know what they're doing, you know, like, who are they? But then I started realizing, like, there's more art in kind of not understanding what you're doing, which is kind of weird. So, so I think it comes from an understanding of that and appreciating that kind of mentality. I have a lot of friends who are geeky like me. A lot of them get into like modular synthesizers because they have, I'm not into modulars. Are you into modulars by any chance?
I'm actually really into, I just got into the kind of modeling of modulars.
Okay,
so Reactor
and
then
this like
MyRack on an iPad. Like,
yes, I just got that.
I've been really into that.
Yeah, MyRack's really cool.
But so, I'm resisting the hardware ones just because it's such a huge wormhole.
Yeah, like a wormhole of getting in and spending money. Yeah. But those tools are great because it provides that, what's happening? I don't know, but it's really cool, you know? And that's a lot of fun. And that's where I feel like a lot of the trap younger guys, they're doing, you know, they're not totally aware of what they're doing, but they're like, this is cool, I like it, and let's just kind of roll with it.
So you're saying that they're having the same experience that you or I would have with a modular?
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. But it's, you know, our experience, since we're so technical, has to be a little bit more geeky, but I find that...
It's a shame.
Yeah, no, it is. It is a kind of shame. I wish I could just like dumb things down in my head sometimes. But yeah, I mean, just that appreciating and understanding of trying to be more artistic and not get so caught up in the technical things, you know. And this is one of the things, at least for me, in terms of getting projects done, one of the nice tips that I think is really great for me and helped me get things done is the use of like placement sounds or just holding sounds. Not because a lot of times when you're working on a track and you're like, oh, I need this bass line, you'll spend hours like tweaking the bass sound trying to get it right. But if you can at least just find a placeholder sound, something that at least fills that void and allows you to move forward.
Yeah.
And then later you can readjust that thing, because it's so easy to just get, you know, just get geeked out on a bass line, on a bass sound for hours. But just find something that's good enough placeholder. And oftentimes when I have that mentality of, oh, this is just a placeholder sound, a lot of times when I work through, I'll just realize like, oh, that's good enough.
Or like just a little bit needed to be changed on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think Captain Beat actually is a little bit of that conceptually for me.
Yeah.
Because I'm the kind of person that doesn't write anything until I have a beat already going.
Oh, do you start with a beat?
I start with a beat.
Oh, you always start with a beat?
I always start with a beat.
That's cool.
And even if it's a placeholder beat, I could end up writing a track without a beat at all, but I'd rather play to a loop or a drum beat than to play to a click.
That's one of the things I do that with people. I like it kind of almost reminds me, the analogy I like is like starting ideas with like different drum loops is almost like paper mache.
Yeah.
You know, where you build something over the structure of something else, but it turns into something like totally mm-hmm. different. That's one of the things I like playing with different, like especially like heavily grooved drum loops that have like different fills and grooves to them. Sometimes I'll make, if I'm even making like a pop or dance track, sometimes I'll use like old 70s drum loops to play parts and get ideas. So it feels a little bit more loose and has that vibrant kind of alive feeling. And then, you know, then go in and just stick a four on the floor underneath it. And then it just has like a little bit more life.
And then your playing already has that pull from that groove.
From the groove, exactly. Yeah. So it's kind of neat. You know, mm-hmm. it kind of gives it, like I said, kind of building something totally different on the structure of something else, you know, is neat.
There's this great video where Pat Metheny's playing like mm-hmm. just straight jazz over a metronome, mm-hmm. and he makes it swing.
Yeah,
like it's like it makes it sound like this incredible like grooving drummer.
Yeah,
it's just a click.
It's just a click.
Yeah, and that was just a lesson to me that you can play with your own rhythm against that beat and give that impression. Mm-hmm. Always.
Yeah, there is something like, I mean, it's all in the rhythm. This is something mm-hmm. like. At Mixing Key, we do these retreats, and mm-hmm. One of the last ones, that was something like, we were just in a discussion, we were talking about things that I was like, it just kind of came out. I don't know who said it, it was like either me or Lewis, but we were like, you know, style is in the rhythm. You know, you can have mm-hmm. chords or chords, but all the style is rhythm. Mm-hmm. Style is 100% rhythm in every, just about everything, you know?
Yeah.
So getting a good rhythm is a lot, you know, especially if you have a good drum loop and it's really grooving, and then mm-hmm. and then taking that out and putting something else in its place, and you have just all these instruments grooving to something that feels really super fresh and organic.
I mean, I think that's why it's important to have some stuff not quantized.
Yes.
You know, you can have most of it quantized, but as long as there's something that's human, mm-hmm. I think it helps a lot.
Yeah, that's one of the things. I don't know, a lot of people don't use it, and I thought it was like one of the most profound things. And in Live 8, they came up with their groove pool, mm-hmm. and their groove pool was fantastic. One of the features it has the ability to extract a groove from mm-hmm. things. And I like to extract grooves from just like even songs that I don't like or different things and just put them into my tracks, because they have, you know, if you got a good groove, you got a good groove, you know.
So it's like a quantized template that you kind of pull.
Yeah, you can pull it out.
Yeah.
I have mm-hmm. one of my buddies, he gave me this library, him and his friend, they spent like a whole weekend just sampling classic records. Mm-hmm. And for years and years and years, I used all those as samples, but being able to extract the grooves out of it, it like brought a whole new life to that library. It was like, mm-hmm. you know, being able to extract grooves, it's almost like getting the essence of something. To me, it feels, it's like sampling 2.0 almost. It's not sonic sampling, but it's like sampling the essence of something, which is really, really pretty interesting to me.
So you combine that with some Melodyne and just like actually taking someone else's sounds and
you can get
the deep fakes of music, right?
Yeah, exactly. The deep fakes of music. I like that. That's pretty crazy.
Just have Miles Davis playing with Steve Ray Vaughan. And
yeah, it's pretty wild. You know, and I think that's where music is heading, because I mean, like, mm-hmm. you know, I find the most interesting things are the things that are mixed together, you know, the different mixing. I don't know if there's going to be this next great genre that's totally different, you know? So I find a lot of stuff's kind of mixing things these days, you know?
I believe there will be, and I believe we'll have no idea what it will be right now.
Like, I mean, I don't know. No one saw dubstep a couple years ago.
So. Yeah. You alluded earlier to having these 10 auxes set up in your session.
Yes.
Tell me more about that. Like, what do you have in there? What do you use?
Okay, so I'm a pretty big fan of UAD. Mm-hmm. So I definitely have on, you know, the first one, I have the Lexicon 224 on there. Then I have like, I love the Ocean Way studio plugin, the Room.
Room emulator?
Emulator. Okay. It's really, really nice, because, you know, mm-hmm. a lot of times, you know, people think reverbs, they always think halls, you know, but, you know, as you start realizing, you get into this, halls can be really kind of messy in the mix and stuff like that. So I'm a big fan of good room reverbs, and the Ocean Way stuff is fantastic. Now, as far as like long reverbs, to me, like I don't know, when I think of a long reverb, I think of plate. So I have the plate 140.
EM 140.
Yeah, the EMT plate 140. Mm-hmm. Plate is like my idea of like the long reverb.
Same here.
Reverb
I use that
sound.
Too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So also a big fan of the Sound Toy stuff. So I have a channel mm-hmm. with a crystallizer. I also have an aux setup with the Eventide harmonizer, the H910, because mm-hmm. I do a lot of vocals, and I even find just because I use the dual version, and I take one and pitch it up like 1 cent and the other one down 1 cent, and I find just a little bit of that on vocals is just magic.
Nice. You know,
just a little bit of that on vocals. Mm-hmm. And like I said before, I always need a quarter note, half note, dotted eighth note delay at some point in time. And I have this set up in Ableton, and Ableton, I think it's in 10, they added this new echo plugin, but it's basically modeled after, it's very similar, at least to me, it sounds a lot, because I actually have one, the Roland Space Echo RE201. It sounds a lot, it gives me that same kind of warm fuzzy feeling.
Echo, yeah.
And it has a great time modulation on it, so you get that kind of chorusy phasiness, you know, and mm-hmm. between your delays, which is great. I think that's about
and it. you put these all, so you do bus sends to these, right?
Yeah, I have them all on aux mm-hmm. on aux
and post or pre.
They're all post usually.
All post.
Yeah, usually most okay. of the time. Yeah.
And then I think the only one that I use, because I use UA plugins yeah. as well. Though I use the Roland Dimension D.
The Studio Dimension. Yeah. Actually, I don't have that one, but I recently got, do you use any of the Valhalla stuff?
No.
Valhalla stuff is great, man. It's super inexpensive, mm-hmm. but they have this one plugin called Ubermod, and it does like the Dimension Chorus. It does a bunch nice. Of that stuff, which is really, mm-hmm. really cool. And it's cool, the Dimension Chorus is classic, but it's cool to have, you know, something that can do that sound as well as a couple other things, like, you know, because the Dimension is like, it's like, what is it, two or three buttons?
Four buttons,
and like, it's like just
but
that.
You can hold more than one of them down at the same
time.
Yeah,
exactly.
I'm actually so into it that I bought, they turn into a guitar pedal.
Oh, yeah.
I bought it. Yeah, that's just cool. Like, I love it.
Well, those old, like, Bucket Brigade courses are like,
They're epic.
They're epic. Mm-hmm. They're just really, really amazing.
So do you mix as you go when you're doing this?
Yes. So this is one of those kind of maddening things, you know, when I sometimes work with students. I do mix as I go. And one of the things that has allowed me to do this is setting up like controller templates for it. Mm-hmm. One of the things that's great is in Ableton you can save a default controller template. So what I have is actually I use this little box from DJ Tech Tools called the Mini Twister, and it's basically mm-hmm. just 16 little knobs. But for a lot of my compressors, basically just about all the compressors that I can, I have basically in, out, threshold, you know, attack, release, all on the same knobs. So basically, mm-hmm. no matter if I'm using like the 1176 or using, you know, something else with attack and release, but the controls are always the same.
So it maps to each one of them?
It maps each one. So my in and out are always the same, my threshold mm-hmm. and my ratio are always the same from compressor to compressor.
Nice.
And this allows me to work unbelievably fast. Mm-hmm. So, and generally, like, my EQs are kind of the same, too. So, this is really kind of revolutionized my workflow because it does allow me to mix and compress. And, you know, I'm really big into sound design, and, you know, I started realizing, you know, like, EQs and compressors can be very valuable sound design tools. So, that's when I started experimenting with mixing as I go a little bit. Because I find it can be a very valuable part of the creative part, you know, quote unquote mixing. So, but the control templates allow me to work really, really fast through different plugins. So I do mix as I go. Also something else that Ableton does helps me with a lot. Especially because you're talking about doing drums, Ableton mm-hmm. has this thing called a drum rack.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that allowed me to realize like, oh, I can actually mix as I go. You use Logic, right? Mm-hmm. Do you use Ultrabeat a lot?
No.
No, you don't use
Ultrabeat. But in Ableton, I will use the drum rack.
Yeah, the drum rack's great. Yeah. And that was one of the things that, because I had used Logic in the past, but you know, when you use Logic and you use Ultrabeat, you know, if you take the kick and you want to process that kick, what do you have to do? You got to send it out. You got to create like an aux. You got to do.
Or you do like a multi-out and then
you're
dealing with that way.
Do all that stuff. But that's one of the great things about the drum rack in Ableton is it already creates all those things for you. So as soon as you drop a sample into the drum rack, it creates an audio chain for you. So it's really easy. You don't have to route and do all this thing. So it's really just simple. Once you drop a sample in there, just drop a compressor right behind that sample. So it makes that workflow is really, really easy. I don't think if I didn't have a drum rack, I don't think I would probably mix as much as I went. You know, that helps me a lot, especially for drums, because everything gets a chain. And then if you want to do bus processing, you just drop it right on top of the drum rack and makes it really, really easy.
I think you'd have to commit to a specific program, because they have those in each one. I mean, you'd like XLN might have a machine you can do it, but
yeah,
you
machine
just have
now
to commit.
You can load plugins. You have to commit to it.
But it's nice that it can be native.
Yeah, it can be native. And that's the cool thing too. Like I've even taken, because there's some contact like drum libraries that I find that I use, especially for like organic drums and stuff. So I spent like a whole day porting those out into the drum rack. So when
nice.
You can, so I can still use the drum rack, and then I have everything audio sent directly into the drum rack into appropriate channels. It took a while to do, but you know, once I have a couple of templates of that, it makes it really, really easy to do. So, but yeah, I do like to mix as I go. It is a little bit maddening. I don't recommend it for everybody. There is something nice too about, you know, flattening everything and then mixing that way. It's definitely, your computer will thank you for it. You know, my computer hates me on a daily basis for sound designing and mixing all at once, because it's definitely harder in terms of CPU usage, you know. There is, I like I said, I mix as I go, but I do sometimes find it very nice when I do basically turn everything into audio and then mix that way. There's definitely some advantages to that. But at least for me, one of the things, you know, I like sound design, so I like to fix mix problems with sound design.
Not with automation.
Yeah, not with automation or EQs and stuff like that. Because, you know, one of the things, like, even just simply like a sample on a kick drum, a kick drum sample, if you use the attack and decay and sustain, you can make it sound like it's been compressed, you know, so you can get it right from the start. You know, you can do it at the sample point without having to add a bunch of other devices to do that. So I find I like to, I was actually teaching this guy, he's actually a Miami artist. He's in this group, Afro Beta. I was teaching him Ableton, and he was asking me to show him some mix stuff. And I was like, man, this sounds great. I was like, this is not mixed. And Tony, who's an Afro Beta, he's really good with synths and tweaking. And that was a real eye-opener to me. And I was like, wow. I was like, man, he's got this stuff sounding great just from a sound design level. So I like to, as much as I can, and this is why I don't like to flatten things down as audio. Because sometimes I'll hear something, I'll be like, man, I could just adjust that filter envelope a little bit and that would probably fix that. You know, so I like to fix things. I don't know, that was maybe just the audio engineering side of me was always like, I was always taught when I went to audio engineering school was like to capture it at its source the best.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
In the box for me, it's like at the synth or at the sample level is the source for me. So.
Well, anything you put on it is a filter of some form.
Yeah.
You know, it's modulating the sound in some way. So
yeah,
you're muddying up that image in a way.
The original image. So I like to try to get the original image as good as possible. But sometimes even in my brain, that does include like an EQ after it. You know, because sometimes some limitations of the synth, you know.
For sure.
You know, so like I don't necessarily think of sometimes when I drop an EQ as that's mixing. I still sometimes think of that as sound design.
What you were just talking about relates to sound instrument plugins. However, like a generative MIDI plugin, like Captain Plugins, how do you relate that into this workflow? Like how would you treat?
One of the things that I like to do with Captain has a really cool thing because it will give you a lot of rhythms, you know. But sometimes I like to keep it really basic and just use the chords, because sometimes synths and patches will give me the rhythm, you know, because sometimes a lot of really cool, you know, presets will have like a pulse to them or something like that. So I can use that kind of as a starting point too.
But in that instance, then what you're doing is you're routing the MIDI from Captain into...
Yeah, I sometimes like to do the real-time MIDI. Mm-hmm. I don't know, I'm a big, I don't know, I like to keep things MIDI as possible. I don't know, there's something just feels cool about like things living and being real-time as much as possible.
Yeah.
But I do a lot of times just for speed, you know, you can just drag the clips out and stuff like that and just drag the clips to different things. But yeah, it's fun to just take even just a basic chord progression and see what you can do within the rhythms of the chord progression. Because sometimes, you know, the most basic chord progressions happen on the bar. You know, the more interesting ones have syncopation in it. But within that syncopation, it's cool to feel the other syncopations that can exist within something like that.
You know what syncopation is because you're a drummer, I know as well, but can you explain syncopation then?
So syncopation is the, I guess like the off rhythms, you know, not what you feel directly as the downbeat, you know, everything opposite of the four on the floor kick, you know.
So,
you know, there's some really interesting things. Sometimes you may have a chord progression that, you know, like I say, most basic chord progressions are always on the one, but sometimes, you know, if you just have a, sometimes like if I'm just working with something like that, if you take like the second chord and slide it over an eighth note, creates that slight anticipatory feeling. You know,
nice.
So your chord comes in on that the and of four as opposed to the one. Mm-hmm. But setting up that sneak in of the next chord, you can hint rhythmically that something is coming up not exactly where you want. Mm-hmm. You know, you do this all the time with melodies. You take a melody and your melody will kind of sometimes hint at the next chord that's coming along. I find you can do that rhythmically. You know, people talk a lot about harmonic tension and using harmonic tension to move things. But as a drummer, I was always like, well, what about rhythmic tension? There's a lot of rhythm. There's a lot of tension that you can do within rhythm to help things progress along. And especially in dance music that is really more rhythmic based, I find that to be more valuable.
So in that way, the syncopation is the two instruments playing rhythmically off of each other.
Yeah. And so for example, if something can feel very down like this, but right before that weird syncopation, you can have other little syncopations that kind of happen right before it. So it doesn't feel just so abrupt. Like it's like, oh, here's like, it's on the, you know, so you can have little things that kind of cue you like, oh, this is going to be not so, you know, downbeat driven, you know. So I find like I said, maybe this is the drummer in me, I find there's a lot you can do with rhythmic tension, you know.
We've talked a lot about the act of making music. Mm-hmm. I think another side of this is, how do you get these jobs to make music for, or how did you yourself, you know, start writing for music libraries and start writing for commercials and so on?
Networking, man. You know, one of the things that, you know, I don't know, I just kind of got lucky, but word of mouth is also something really good for me. So, you know, whenever I work with people, I always make sure that I have a good rapport with them, you know, because every single job I've gotten has been basically because of something else, someone I knew from a previous situation. That's actually how I got into working for that music house. I was actually teaching at an audio engineering school, and a guy took my class, and when I would teach, I would make stuff a lot, and you just kind of on the fly, because, you know, I find that's a little bit more organic instead of having, you know, just some stuff already set up. This guy was like, man, you make music really well on the fly. I think I have this company. I think you would be really good for it. So I started, he had a couple of projects. He was like, I want to send you a project and see what you could do on it. And it turned out really well. And he ended up hiring me on full time. And that's how I got into Mixed in Key. It had been originally my job with Mixed in Key. I was working at that music house, and Yakov actually contacted me to teach him Ableton, and then started teaching him Ableton, and everything went good, and he was just like, why don't you come work for my company?
Nice.
So So it's really good. I find it really important, you know, even if it's the smallest job or the smallest thing, you know, approach it with the utmost professionalism, because you never know, like, this could be this littlest thing, but this guy could be connected to something huge that could open lots of doors for you, you know. Mm-hmm. The other thing that has opened a lot of doors for me, at least, is the Ableton certification has definitely opened a lot of doors for me, because I have a profile on their website, so people find me, you know, whenever they're looking for Ableton help. So that has done quite a lot for me, you know, in terms mm-hmm. of my career and opening doors for me.
So in addition to just being like a great set of skills that it's added, it's also been great for work.
Oh, it's been absolutely fantastic for work. And that's the other thing too. I mean, like, you know, certifications are good. You know, they're great. Mm-hmm. If you're a big Pro Tools user, get the Pro Tools certification. Does mm-hmm. Logic still do their certification?
I don't know.
Yeah, I know there was a Logic certification. I had a friend who used to do a lot of that stuff. But those things can be good. They can open up a lot of doors for you. The Ableton certification opened up a lot of doors for me. I've done everything from working, it's open mixed and key. It's even allowed me to, you know, do a setup on the main stage at Ultra, and just all sorts of different stuff just by people contacting me for Ableton help.
And your music technology side that you've brought up a few times, can you tell me a bit more about that? I know that you've done some sound creation.
Yeah, sound creation. The other thing, like that thing that I did for Ultra, this is actually a pretty growing field now, playback systems. And I did this in like 2009, 2010, before like Ableton was really big known as a playback system. The artist I was working with, he had some tracks that he needed to play back and do video and have performers, but he wasn't comfortable with them just living on with just one laptop. So what I had to do was I built a redundancy system, which was basically two laptops. So if one laptop failed, the other one would pick up, because, you know, when you're in front of tens of thousands of people at Ultra, you definitely want a safety net. You know, you just don't want to ride it all on one laptop.
So, absolutely.
So so it's a lot of that. Also setting up studios. I worked at my music technology side comes from, I worked in a music store for years, and I used to sell people a lot of gear. And then it kind of turned into, hey, can you help me set this stuff up? So, and then that kind of turned into, yeah, I can help you build studios and create the technical side that will help your workflow be the most productive kind of stuff for people, mm-hmm. you know.
You mentioned you work with Mixed and Key.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a bit more what you do with them?
Well, primarily what I've done a lot, at least recently, was a lot of the sound design for the Captain products. Did a large majority of the sound design for Captain Chords, Captain Beat, and Captain Deep, just all that Captain stuff. But I also help, you know, a little bit with some of the direction. You know, I consult with the company, and, you know, I work in the field. So they always kind of contact me with where do you think we should go? What's the kind of like the most important direction? We have these feature lists. What do you think is most important we add? What's going to make the producer the most happy, kind of thing? So
yeah.
I do some of that, and even had the fortunate opportunity of doing a little bit of like UX and stuff, or early conceptual ideas of the Captain Chords plugins and stuff like that. I helped mm-hmm. a bit with like the layout of how the chords and like the sliders and stuff like that was really interesting, and it was just something that I would have never imagined. You know, as a producer, you work with these programs all the time, and you're like, man, I wish it would do this, but it's been so surreal to be involved in that process and be like, actually talk to a developer and be like, hey, can it do this? Can we make it do this? And it actually is in the program. It's one of like the most rewarding things I've ever been involved in. Would have never imagined I would have had the opportunity to do something like that.
So what are common mistakes that new producers make trying to produce tracks?
For me, one of the things that I find most valuable in terms of helping like young producers like progress was something I alluded to earlier, is like trying to get songs done. You know, one of the things I find a lot of people, especially in today's age, is a lot of people get stuck in that 16-bar loop. Try not to do that. If you got a 16-bar loop, make a B section. You know, most songs, you know, I approach it like, I like to tell people, like, making a song, approach it like you would a house. You know, you just don't start building a kitchen and then be like, oh, I need a bedroom. I need like a living room. You know, your house would look like an absolute disaster if you did that. You know, if you build a house, you're gonna be like, hmm, what do I want? Open floor plan, I want like 3-4, all this stuff. So that's what I tell people to do when you're approaching a song is think about the track you wanna make and get all the boring stuff out of the way. Because a lot of people are kind of genre specific. So if you're genre specific, there's certain criteria that kind of have to be met for that genre. You know, if you're making a pop song, you know, you want at least like verse, chorus, maybe a bridge, verse, chorus. So if you're working on a pop song, write a verse, you know, figure out what your chorus is going to be, and maybe work on a bridge. If you're doing a dance song, something, usually stuff's like usually like A section, B section, maybe a C section. Work on your A section, which is your 16 bar groove. Don't get too deep into that. Immediately start working on your B section. The other analogy I like to throw out there, it's like building a road to nowhere. You know, you just don't start building a road and not have an idea of where you're going. You know, that's what I equate the A section to the B section is at least if you have a planned path to go somewhere, it becomes a lot more productive. So if you at least have a direction of where your song is gonna go, I find it to be really, really super helpful. And immediately start laying out your song. Get into the arrangement of your song as soon as possible. Lay it out. And you know, once your song is laid out, like it's a song, it's done. I mean, at any point in time, you could be like, that's it. And if that's what you intend, then no one can question you. You may not like it, but if that's what you intended, that's what it is. So no one can really say anything. So, but you can't just have a 16 bar loop and call that a song. You know, so lay out your tracks and get the arrangement done as soon as possible. I found that to be one of the best things that has helped advance some of my students in terms of being productive and getting things done is just get into the arrangement of your track as soon as possible. And that'll help you finish. Because that's something I said earlier, you know, like being able to finish songs is the most important thing. Like you wouldn't go to an architect. And if an architect showed you a bunch of half-finished houses, you wouldn't hire that guy, right? You
know? No, and I think that gets to a way that I think of it in a different way, but it's the same thing. Mm-hmm. I think about, like, what's the meat? Like, yeah. What's the most important thing of this section or of that section?
Exactly.
And I like it, actually, I like it to be something different every time.
Okay.
So I kind of like to think of, right now I'm focused on melody, right now I'm focused on chords, right now there's a breakdown. I try and keep these things moving.
Yeah.
And it's like, I just want to know what's the substance.
Yeah.
Exactly. What's important here.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like the same thing. Mm-hmm. Like another analogy, I always talk about cars. You know, a lot of times people, when they produce, they feel like they need to reinvent the wheel.
Yeah.
You know, and you don't have to just use same things. It's like, if you're going to build a car, you wouldn't be like, everyone's using wheels. I'm not going to use wheels. You know, that would just be ridiculous. We mm-hmm. use wheels because it's the best option we figured out. And there's certain things like that in songwriting and production, you know?
Every songwriter you know plays the same instrument on all their tracks. They use the same chords that they have
exactly.
under their hands or on their instruments.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's
and not, the other thing, not that, trying the other thing that I always tell people all the time is when have you ever heard anyone complain about song structure? Have you ever heard anyone complain, oh, verse, chorus, bridge, I'm so sick of hearing that. I've never heard anyone say
no.
that.
No.
And you can use the same arrangement of the song over and over again, and you know people really won't notice, or at least use stuff that people have used. I've never heard anyone complain
about it. It's there for a reason.
It's exactly. I've never heard anyone complain about song arrangement. Like, oh, you know, so you know, use that stuff. We do that stuff because so many people, thousands of people have been doing this way before you ever did and have figured all this stuff out. And it'd be ridiculous for you not to use their insight into these things. And these people have figured all that stuff out. So use it. You know, you don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Where do you see the future going in terms of music, technology, production? What do you think is going to happen, and what would you like to happen?
Well, there's definitely some interesting things. You know, we were talking about generative tools. You know, I definitely think, you know, machine learning and AI definitely has a hand in kind of what the future has to hold, I definitely think there's some interesting things there, you know, because I do like generative tools, and you know, I definitely think there's some things on the horizon for, you know, machine learning and AI tools to help kind of almost be that extra person in the room. You know, I don't think we'll ever get to the point where computers are making whole songs and doing all this thing, but I think they could definitely, computers could be a valuable kind of thing to bounce and give creative ideas back and forth with. I think computers have the ability to do that. And it has for me in smaller senses, you know, like patches, or, you know, you mangle a sample in a weird way and it kind of gives you this thing. So I think there's a lot of room for machine learning, AI stuff in the music production world. I think there's some really interesting things that could be had in that area.
Mm-hmm. Well, Mike, I want to thank you so much for coming
today. Oh, thank you, man. It's been a pleasure.
It was a great conversation.
Yeah, thank you. I had a blast.
For our audience, where can they find you online if they want to?
They can find me online. I have a website, MikeCupino.com. You can also find my profile on the Ableton website.
Awesome. Cool. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Talk soon.
Awesome.